My name is Dana, and I'm from New Hampshire. As David said, I have four kids. I have two boys and two girls. And my journey started, actually, just about 17 years ago, next month. 17 years ago, my son Devin was born, and I had him in the hospital. I had no idea that I was capable of having a natural birth. And let me just say, everything started for me from that point. Everything I had heard and everything I had read petrified me to have to give birth naturally. However, I had a midwife, and she encouraged me that the first step into mothering was to be able to do it under my own power. And so she supported me through a really long, intense labor. He was almost 10 pounds when he was born, and I couldn't believe that I had done it, actually. I have an audio tape of his birth, and all you can hear after I pushed him out was, I did it, I can't believe I did it. Because I was never a confident person. I was never a confident little girl. I was shy. I'm still shy, but I have a message. So that propels me and pushes me to be, you know, to go forward and share with all of you. After his birth, I remember holding him, and he was being cleaned up, and he was nursing, which was another mind-blowing experience. I couldn't believe that my body could sustain him for the time that I nursed him, but it was amazing and empowering. Well, within an hour of his birth, the nurses came in, and they came in to check on us, and they turned on the television. They said, "Do you want the TV on?" And I said, "Yeah, sure, why not?" And it was about 9 in the morning, and the Columbine shootings were happening live. And I'll never forget, it's really emotional for me, because I'll never forget holding him and looking down and realizing that all these people were losing their children as I was holding mine and bringing mine forth. And I just wanted them all to have that moment that I was experiencing. And it was this really intense moment where I cried, and it's been forever tattooed in my mind. And now I feel like I know why that happened within moments after his birth, because I feel like I was put here, my children were put here, and those of you that are inspired to advocate for something different, it all was lined up perfectly. I thought to myself as I saw these kids jumping out of windows and mothers crying, and it was amazing to me that they were filming this live without the sacredness of these parents' privacy. So it felt like really invasive to watch this intense moment for them. And I remember thinking, how many of those parents and how many of those kids would have preferred to have been home together that day? How many of them felt as though they had no choice? And I thought to myself right then and there that my children would always have the choice whether to attend school or not. I never pictured myself as a homeschooling parent. In fact, I thought, I never pictured myself as radical at all. That's what was funny. I was kind of always a metalhead in school and hung out with like the tough kids and smoked cigarettes in the bathroom and listened to heavy metal. I was always kind of a rebel, but I never pictured myself a mother like this. So let me tell you, this isn't something I envisioned ever promoting or speaking about. It just happened so naturally and so beautifully that I'm really inspired to share. I never envisioned sharing it on the platform that I have. It started 10 years ago when the Dr. Phil Show contacted me and our family spoke about this life. It was the longest running message boards ever in Dr. Phil history. It went for 2.5 years after our show aired about unschooling. It was there that I knew that this life would be really sensationalized as well. I knew that anytime I said yes to any media appearances, that more than likely it was going to show what we didn't do as opposed to what we did do. So I'm here to share with you what we do instead of school, what we do instead of school curriculum. And not only that, but what we do instead of an authoritarian parenting dynamic. It wasn't very long ago that men were told to beat their wives if dinner wasn't on the table on time. If you look back in our history, it's really provocative and mind-blowing how that was literally promoted by the town minister, by fathers, grandfathers, friends. They would train husbands in how to get their wives to obey them, and it's even in the marriage vows, and some people still repeat that today. Well, we've come really far from that time. And Radical Unschooling, this is an educational event, I realize that. We're going to be focusing on education and alternative education and education and freedom. However, what I want you all to know more than that is that this is a whole parenting and life philosophy, what I'm sharing with you today. Children's rights are on the forefront of what I do, sharing with you about how, much like what husbands were told to control their wives, and we've come so far from that, to the point where men are arrested if they beat their partners, the same thing is happening with the movement of children's rights and advocacy. I look forward to a day where we look back on times where children were spanked and punished punitively as shameful and embarrassing at our time in history. What? Yes, she's empathizing completely. So what I want to share with you is unschooling, radical unschooling, is a twofold philosophy. There's the unschooling side of it, which is living life without school. I think you've heard a lot of great speakers sharing about the alternatives as far as that goes. A lot of things you're going to hear me talk about are going to be really radical and maybe new, and you might gasp and you might say, oh my gosh, I could never live that way. But I think you'd be surprised. The further you go down this path, the more open you are and the less crazy it sounds. There's a lot of de-schooling that you all need to go through to embrace this life. There's a lot of realizing how conditioned and brainwashed you've been to see things in schooly terms, schooly words, schooly categories, broken down into subjects, math, English, science. We don't live life like that at all as unschoolers. We just live life. My kids have never done a workbook page. They've never done a curriculum. They've never been to school. And not only that, but our children have never been punished. Now, I'm going to bring both of these aspects together for you to understand more clearly, but one thing I want to share is that, do you realize that 99% of parenting books on the market today are focused on meeting the parents' needs? The parents' needs, pretty much only. The parents' needs for quiet, uninterrupted sleep, and above all, obedience and compliance. And that's exactly what schools do. If you start to research the history, which I really encourage you to do, John Taylor Gatto is near and dear to David's heart, as well as mine. He endorsed my book. He writes extensively on the true history of American education. I recently learned that it was in Massachusetts. I live in New Hampshire, and it was in Massachusetts the first time that compulsory schooling ever came to be. And do you know that 80% of parents protested? 80% of parents, when they brought the idea to Massachusetts, to the US for the first time, said, no way are you gonna condition my children for obedience. And they were forced by gunpoint to bring their children that first day of compulsory school. How do we come so far as to now thinking it's good for us? It's really important to educate yourself to the history of why schools came to be if you ever want to kind of undo all of that and understand the intention behind it. I've heard people say it's like a conspiracy theory, and they think that it's really far-fetched to hear that schools are made to condition children to take orders, but truthfully, they're made to condition to fit into the system, to be cogs in the machine. And if you condition a child to take orders early enough, they very easily fit into a cubicle and do what they're told, and they don't ever really go on, most of them. There are the exceptions, however, but there are some that usually never go on to be anything more than working for somebody else. What I'm promoting with Radical Unschooling and many others are promoting are for our children to be free-thinking entrepreneurs and to not take orders and to find their passion and interest in life and to make money off of it and be happy doing so. We're not all meant to learn the same things in life. And I think that's really important. I think you've all heard things similar to that, and you've heard that saying, but truthfully, why on earth would we give every human the same curriculum to learn when we all have our strengths and we all have our weaknesses and we all have our purpose? How many of you have really found your purpose? Doesn't it feel amazing? You know, this is mine, and I can't even tell you how good it feels to be pursuing it and doing it. And when you allow your children to find who they are and to follow their purpose and freedom, they live a happy life. You know, most people are raised, they're conditioned to jump through all these hoops, and they're told that once they get to the end and they retire someday, they'll finally be happy. That success is the key to happiness. But we're living that happiness now, and we're showing the world that it's not that way at all. It's actually backwards. Happiness is the key to success. So people might say to me, you know, how are your kids ever going to learn to be socialized? How are they ever going to learn to, you know, work for somebody else, to take orders? And I say that's not our goal. My goal is not obedience. My goal is not compliance. My goal is for my children to be happy. So let's talk a little bit more about that aspect. One thing that's really interesting, and I love this location. It's really funny. We have a YouTube channel, my family. It's called the Sparkling Martins, and it's really fun because you get to share with a younger generation. A lot of kids watch us. And my saying that kind of just happened, and the kids always write it to me, as all is well. And I can't believe right now I'm looking. On the back of the wall, that is what I'm known for with the younger generation, is that saying. And they draw me pictures, and they say, all is well. And it's important when you find your purpose to find the way that you want to pursue it, because there's so many different ways. For me, advocating to all different generations is important. I love advocating to adults in this kind of forum. I love advocating to kids, because kids get this. They hear you, and they know that they're finally understood. So one thing I was sharing with a couple people earlier is, what I'm sharing with you today isn't necessarily new to you. I'm not here bringing this whole philosophy that'll blow your mind and you've never heard before. It might kind of seem that way, maybe in little bits, but I'll tell you that you all know this. This is all instinctual. This was born with you. We were all meant to come into this world and be free. And we are all meant to find who we are and to pursue our passions and to learn and grow as human beings and have purpose in the world and make a difference. Those that are doing this thing, it might seem kind of exceptional, like, wow, they're really making a difference in this world. But do you know that you're all meant to do that in your own way? You're not all meant to be like everybody else. You're not all meant to go through the same process. So I think understanding children's rights is really paramount in understanding alternatives and options in education. Because what keeps people from taking their kids out of school? Fear. And so it's my job, I feel like, to help you guys feel less afraid. So if I can tell you my radical approach, you might say to yourself, wow, if she's doing it, that's way out there. I could at least do this. My kids learn in a lot of different ways. So I will say that I'm not my child's teacher. I'm not standing in front of them, pouring knowledge into them, like the all-knowing authority. So what do I do? I'm willing to bet that at least half of you think that this is really permissive and that I probably don't do much. So your kids just run around crazy all day and, oh, that's lazy. How do you do that? I've heard that, trust me. Dr. Phil himself had that opinion, which was intense to handle and to advocate for. I will tell you that this life is not for the lazy parent. It's actually quite the opposite. When you're living in an authoritarian dynamic, rules are easy. It might not be pleasant, but rules are a replacement for being there. And that's an important aspect to understand, that our kids aren't living in a space constantly preparing for the future like most kids in our culture. Every day they sit at a desk for 8 hours a day and learn things that other people think is important, because they know that someday they might need it as adults. So it's like this constant preparation for the future mentality. Then we're adults and we say to ourselves, like, wow, I just really want to learn how to live in the now. Like, I just so want to, like, zen out. We, like, we find yoga. We find all different ways to so desperately try to get back to our natural state. You were once at your natural state. If we all were raised this way, we may not have a whole need for a lot of yoga teachers and things like that. So I guess they might frown on me for saying this, but we're not meant to need to stress and find and try to figure out how to breathe and be present and be in the now. That was conditioned out of us, that natural way of being. So this life philosophy is very present-based. We're not living life, you know, based on the future. It's kind of like, let me give you the analogy of, like, what if you were all here in this room for 8 hours a day, every day, I don't know, for 10 years, to prepare you for retirement? You have to learn how to, you know, what's going to happen when you retire. You're not going to know your options. You're not going to know what your purpose is. We need to tell you, thank you. We need to tell you how to focus on retirement, and you'll never learn. Think of how dull and awful that would be. That's exactly how kids in school feel, preparing for their adulthood that they can't even fathom right now. So learning feels really good. That's not something you hear people necessarily say. Learning is supposed to, by nature, feel good and be enjoyable. You know how it feels when someone's speaking to you and you're so thirsty for what they have to say. It feels so good to obtain knowledge that you've been searching for. Do you know that's how it feels for every human? That your kids are supposed to feel that every day. And my kids do. They have no concept of what it would be like for learning to be difficult. My son Devin, when he was a little bit younger, he was jumping on the trampoline with a neighbor boy that came over. A family, their kids are in school. We've known them since they were really little. Well, the little boy was jumping on the trampoline and he said to Devin, "Oh, I have to go home, I have my homework to do, I hate history." And Devin said, "What? Like, what are you talking? You hate history? What do you mean? Like, how can you hate history?" He's like, "I just hate it. I never want to learn it. I hate it. I cheat. I do everything I can to get out of the class." And Devin came to me later, like, "What is he talking about? Like, how can somebody hate our history? I don't understand it." I said, "Well, I think what he means is he hates his history class, and he hates to be forced to do any kind of schoolwork having to do with history against as well." And it kind of opened Devin's eyes to, and he has had some great insight about it, that if you introduce a child to something that they're not interested in, and you really force them to do it, it really negatively affects that child with the relationship of whatever that was, sometimes for the rest of their life. How many of you think that you're bad at math? Like, you're so, I know I'm one of them. I when I see numbers, I'm just like, I'm terrible. I've kept that identity my whole life because of my experience in school. So what this philosophy is about from the unschooling educational aspect is realizing that forced learning doesn't work. That forced learning not only doesn't work, but it sets your child up for like great dislike of a lot of important and interesting things later in life because they were forced to do it against their will. And plus, forced learning and memorizing something for a test isn't really learning. It's not. And I think that's really important for you to wrap your head around, that memorization is not true learning. So a child that's forced to jump through hoops, I mean, I can remember being in a class where I had to learn the capital of every single country in the world for this advanced college course, and I couldn't do it. And this is the interesting part about control and forced learning that I know a lot of you are going to relate to. And it kind of hurts deep down to share this with you, but I cheated. Because I couldn't deal with the negative that would have come from the judgment of letting the teacher down. I was a total people pleaser. I didn't want to let the teacher down. I didn't want to fail the class. I was put in this class, and I was so honored to be in this like advanced college class. It turned me into somebody that I wasn't. Now, when you try to control another human being, whether it's with education or parenting, any kind of control in general, their need, their underlying need, will always come before the need of the other person, whether it's for obedience or compliance or whatever. So it does warp us as human beings when somebody forces us in that dynamic and we become people that we're not, which then in turn gives us low self-esteem, and it kind of will be a downward spiral for us in a lot of ways. So when you're saying to your child, "You have to learn this," and the child has no interest, they're either going to study it, memorize it, and forget it, just to jump through hoops, or they're going to have to cheat or lie. How many of you can remember a time in school where you felt like you were forced to lie or cheat? And I guarantee that so many of you carried that awful feeling with you, because not only that, but you were told how bad that was and how wrong, and you had fear of getting in trouble and getting punished. That's the overlying idea behind the authoritarian paradigm with education and parenting. That if you try to control, force, or limit something, the human being will change as a result of that, because everyone's need for freedom and their own agenda, they're naturally designed for their own agenda and need to learn to come first. We're designed that way. So I think that's an important aspect of it. I'm not my child's teacher, but what I am instead is my child's learning facilitator. And I think that's really important, because when you consider homeschooling, a lot of people are told, "Well, how are you going to do that? You're not a teacher." And I like to tell people that I'm definitely not a teacher. I did go to school for early childhood education, but it's actually what turned me onto this path, because I learned how wrong forced learning was way back then. But what you're supposed to do instead, and not just for your kids, but for anybody you love, to facilitate their interests is an extension of your love for them. So if my kids are interested in something, now this is how unschoolers learn generally. When they have an interest, I like to think of it as the nucleus of their learning. So if one of my kids has an interest, I try to bring as much into their lives to learn and grow from based on those interests. And although we're not breaking life down into subjects like people in school do, or traditional homeschoolers, if you were to break what we do down into subjects, you would see that it touches on every subject. So I think that's important to point out there for those of you that still have that school mentality, which probably most of you do. It's understandable. You would see that it does touch on every single subject. Now, for example, when my son Devin was 4 or 5, and I've given this example before because it's the first time I really remember getting so excited about this role, he was into Legos. So I brought as much into his life to learn and grow from based on that one interest. We subscribed to Lego Magazine, so we would have the written word. Now, if kids are interested in something, they're internally motivated to pursue resources to further their knowledge. Reading, writing, and math are all tools to help us get more of what we want in life. They're not these difficult, awful things to learn. Reading, writing, and math are all easy, very easy to learn, when they're used in true context based on what we love. Now that kind of goes against everything that most of us were taught to know. My kids have never done a phonics page. They've never had that paper where they practice writing their name. We never sat down and went over capitals and lowercase letters. It did happen as a side effect of living life. They ask me questions and I answer, and they all have different resources that they're drawn to. But they learned to read, just like they learned to walk and talk. It was a useful tool that helped them get more of what they want in life. Now, natural reading and writing happen in a different way. It happened in a really different way than it does like with traditional school or curriculum. And I think it's kind of shocking to some people that natural reading happens anywhere between the age of like 5 and 11 or 12, sometimes later, sometimes earlier. There's a huge range of reading readiness, but you've all been conditioned. I could tell by your faces, you're all been conditioned to think that it has to happen around 6 or 7 years old. And if it happens before then, the child's gifted and a genius, which is an awful label, I'll tell you, to live with, as well as being put in, my husband was put in the resource room, which I'm not sure what they call it, different things, but he was labeled dyslexic at a very young age and wasn't allowed to take an English class with his class. And even today, he doesn't spell well because he refuses to pursue that because he thinks he's dumb at it, just like I do with math. So I'm the speller of the family now, and he answers the math questions, which is funny, just to prove a point that it does stay with you for a long time. Excuse me. Isn't this church beautiful? Isn't this the best place to have something like this? I love it. I wish we had something like this where I lived. Excuse me. I recently returned from Mexico with David was there actually, and Nathan and some other people that are here. Yes, my friend back there. I spoke in Acapulco, Mexico last week. It's been a lot of traveling and a lot of kids' colds being passed around, and I'm pretty much over it, but my throat's a little. So, reading, writing, and math happens quite naturally when your children have a need and use for the tool. And what human being wouldn't want to know how to read, write, and do math, for example, to help them get more of what they want? Well, I'm going to give you an example. My son Devin was probably around 7 years old, and he started playing this game online called RuneScape. It's kind of like World of Warcraft, but for younger kids. Now, I was told by family and friends how much that would damage him to let him play. But he found it very useful. And he so wanted to know what the other people were saying, because it's one of those games that you chat with other players online. And so he would ask me, what does this say? What does that say? And he, little by little, was so motivated to take part in the game with other people that he learned to read. It was a total immersion experience. Now, I had read to him since he was little. I remember reading him books from when he was in utero. You know, I would read to him. And so we've always read to our kids. That's really natural. We have a home with a huge library, rich with resources. He's surrounded with a written word in a lot of ways. And so that's definitely an aspect of unschooling that I think is important. You want your children to have a huge, you know, resource base to draw from, but never be forced to use. That's important. And he learned how to chat with people, and he put things together, and that game actually inspired him in a lot of other ways too. Let me just say that the parenting side of it and the educational side of it go hand in hand, and I'm going to share both sides of it, and at the end it will come together for you. An aspect of living this life is letting go of fear. We're told to control our kids by people that want to control us. And so they know that if they train parents to control kids, that it'll be less work for them, you know, later on. And what I mean by that is we're all conditioned to live a certain way that benefits other people more than it benefits us. And we've kind of been put in a situation where we think certain things are really valuable, and we judge certain things as less, you know, less worthy than other things. But when you live this life, you learn to break down those walls. And you know, if you had a child who was 11 years old studying Egyptian history, man, you would be so proud of that. You'd feel like the best parent. You'd tell everybody, oh, she's just studying Egyptian history. You'd feel like such a good homeschooling parent. Now, this is like a homeschooling parent thing. But when your child's playing Minecraft at the same age, and that's pretty much what their passion is, it's a little harder because you know you're speaking to people that don't value that. However, it's so important when you're walking a path with your children in partnership that you learn to find value in the learning in every single thing they're choosing without judgment. And that is on us. The de-schooling aspect of this life is easy for kids. They get it. This is the way, you know, we should have been raised. This is the way that humans are meant to learn. So kids come to this life for freedom and pursuing their passions quite naturally. But us, it triggers a lot in us. A lot in fathers. It's interesting. Fathers have totally different triggers walking this path than mothers do, I found. I remember when Devin was 2 years old, my firstborn, and I was researching peaceful parenting, and I told my husband, like, I don't want to spank him, I don't want to hit him, and that's not okay, and I really don't want to do timeouts either, and here's why. And my husband's always been really supportive. I kind of research, he takes it in, he's been very open-minded, asks me questions, but he really trusts me, and I love that. I'm really grateful for having a husband that trusts me like that. But I can remember one day he said, okay, this, I just have to say something. I feel so gypped. And I said, well, what do you mean? And he said, you know, my whole life I was raised and I had to obey everybody. I had to obey my parents, I had to obey teachers, I had to obey everybody. And I thought, once I'm a parent, it'll finally be my turn. I'll finally be able to just throw orders out, and they'll just, the minions will just serve me and obey me, and it won't be a hassle. And here you're telling me we're not going to go that route. Like, I just need time to mourn a little bit. He said, I get it. I support the philosophy, fully get it, but man, it sucks that I didn't have this. And there's a lot of people that feel they have a hard time accepting a new dynamic, a new parenting paradigm, because they feel like if I went through it, you have to go through it. And somehow they feel like they heal, or it's justified if they force somebody else to go through the type of life that they had. Now, we're not living in an authoritarian parenting dynamic, which is what 99% of parents do, which is what I shared with you. The obedience focus and behavior modification is the main goal. Have you guys seen shows like Nanny, Super Nanny, and those kind of shows, or seen that approach? Yeah, that's pretty abusive. I don't know if you've ever been triggered and saw how, but it is to focus on behavior only with another human being. Most parents are told to focus on behavior and behavior modification, and we've somehow thought that timeouts are more compassionate than spanking, for example. On the surface, it may seem to be, because you're not hitting another human being, but you're doing the exact same thing emotionally by not allowing them to have their own needs met, and all that matters is behavior. What I'm introducing to you is an idea of a partnership-based parenting paradigm. And there's a lot of people out there advocating for this in different ways. John Holt in the 1970s started talking about this. Alfie Cohen, have you heard of him? He's an amazing author. I encourage you to check out some of his work on conditional parenting. He talks a lot about this as well. And this is a really important aspect to understand, that we don't focus on our kids' behavior, and we don't punish our kids for their behavior. What we do instead is focus on the needs under their behavior. Now it's pretty mind-blowing. Even though I'm just saying these words, most people do not do that at all. I encourage you to watch. Do a search for Super Nanny and watch it. I showed a couple episodes, clips of it in my talk that I did about compassion in Mexico, and it was pretty shocking for people that all that mattered was obedience, and a child was forced to sit on the naughty step or the naughty stool when they didn't obey. Not once did anybody even discuss why the child was upset. Do you know how excruciatingly frustrating it is? I want you to transport yourself to an argument with your partner or your mother or your friend. When you were so upset about something, you were tired or hungry and you were just pissed and you didn't have patience and you just said something and they said, "Don't yell at me." And you're like, "I'm just, please just listen to what I'm saying. I didn't mean to yell." You know how excruciatingly frustrating it is for someone to try to control how you say something to them instead of just helping you when you're in desperate need, somebody you love, you just want them just to give you a free pass just with your behavior this time and just like hear you because they love you and they understand you're not a mean person. And I mean, that's how children feel raised in our culture with what's being promoted every single day, constantly. One of the videos, the little girl didn't want to eat her dinner because she had eaten before dinner and she wasn't hungry. And that's all she was trying to communicate, but nobody was listening to her. The interesting thing was, not only do children need to be trained to be obedient and have their behavior modified, but parents need to be trained in how to be oppressors. This doesn't come natural to parents to punish with timeouts or spanking. It's not natural. How many of you heard, and I know probably all of you, "This hurts me more than it hurts you"? Do you ever really think about that? Parenting is not supposed to hurt like that, ever. Parenting is supposed to feel good and be joyful. Yes, there's struggles, there's issues, like in any relationship, but parenting by nature is supposed to feel good. And if somebody has to train parents in how to oppress and shut that off, there is something deeply wrong. Now, I'm a big fan of the saying by Maya Angelou, "You did then what you knew how to do. When you knew better, you did better." For parents that have never heard about this, please don't beat yourself up about it. This can trigger deep, deep emotions within people who were raised this way. When they're finally validated, there's something inside of us that screams when we hear this philosophy. "I was right. All those years, I knew this was wrong." And I can remember it on so many levels. So again, what I'm trying and attempting to do is awaken within you a deeply held instinctual knowing that you all were born with. And sharing with you the tip of the iceberg, a very small bit of this philosophy on a different way to look at it. Now, peaceful parenting, radical unschooling, there's a lot of different labels for it. Radical unschooling is different from traditional unschooling. And there is a traditional unschooling. Can you believe it? We've evolved that much. Traditional unschooling is just focused on learning and educational freedom and living life without school. Unschooling, the term was coined in the 1970s by John Holt. And it was kind of a joke when it started out. He had seen a 7-Up commercial about the Un-Cola and thought, I think we should do unschooling. And he never knew what it would be, that it would blow up to this big. Now, unschooling is trust with education. And radical unschooling is taking that trust and extending it, not just in education, but other areas of your children's life. These are the hard ones, because you guys are all here. You want to know about alternative education. The parenting thing might be a little harder for you to wrap your head around, but I encourage you just to hear me out. You can say how crazy I am on the ride home. It's okay. I hear it all the time. But my children don't have any limits. They have complete freedom when it comes to bedtime, the food they eat, and media technology. I'd love to hear what people envision my house must be like, what our life must be like, because it's nothing like you think. This is not just me. This is people that are living this life. My friend Nathan here in the front row, his beautiful children, he has 2 young kids. They have the same freedoms in their life is much like mine. It's really great to hang out with other people who are living this life because you see for yourself that this isn't crazy. The kids aren't disrespectful. When you trust children, they make really good choices for themselves. It makes sense for my kids to brush their teeth before bed. It just makes sense. Their mouth tastes better when it's clean. They understand that when they don't brush their teeth that they get cavities and have to get them filled when they hurt. It's a common sense approach to life that children really resonate with. And when you're not trying to control and limit and punish, the focus can be on what it's about, and that's nutrition and health, instead of their innate desire for freedom, which will override everything when their freedom's not respected, forcing them to have a very unnatural relationship with things and causing them to like overuse or overindulge or you know, your idea of what children would do with freedom is probably not really what children would do with freedom. More than likely, it was a parent who was very controlling with something, who let go of controls, and their children didn't know when they'd be limited again, and so did nothing but that thing. Or it's a parent who is genuinely permissive or neglectful and isn't really involved. I'm willing to bet that you've probably never seen children raised in this paradigm, but you're going to see more of them. And you're going to see how it's changing the world by them being a living example of truly motivated people who want to learn. So we're raising free-thinking entrepreneurs. My son Devin, when he was about 3, and I use him as an example a lot because it was really, everything he did to me was so profound and it really helped my advocacy. My other kids did just as many amazing things, but Devin's stories are kind of just deeply ingrained in who I am, and I love to share with you because they were so empowering to me at the time and so huge. When he was 3, he loved fire. He loved everything about fire. Come to find out when I researched it, that's really natural in boys. Boys are drawn to fire. It amazes them. It empowers them. They love it. They want to be around it. Excuse me for one sec. I need an IV while I'm talking. That would be awesome. Constant drip of water. Now, family and friends told me that I shouldn't let Devin play with fire, that I have to tell him no and that it'll hurt him. And I remember thinking, like, why? I'm going to be with him. And people were just, you're going to be with him? Like, that's amazing that you're going to be with him. He just set a rule and he has to obey it. And I'm like, no, if I'm with him, he can check it out. I sat in the cellar with him in front of our wood furnace for hours and hours, for weeks and months. He would light matches and light things on fire in the wood stove. He'd get paper and light them on fire. And he would sit at the kitchen table with candles and light them and put them out. And he'd play with the wax. He'd put the wax on his fingertips. Do you guys ever do that when you were little? He was fascinated with fire. Because he had that freedom and respect, now keep in mind, it's very important for me to share that this is not permissive, that here's some matches, go have fun, 3-year-old. That would be very neglectful. That's not what this life is. But that's what people think this life is when they first hear about it, so keep that in mind. If you share this with somebody, they're going to instantly think, like, oh my gosh, that's crazy. No, what this life is being present with your kids. It's a lot of work. It's hands-on. I'm going to say it again, this is not for the lazy parent. It's a lot more work than the authoritarian paradigm where you just put out a rule and punish if they don't obey it. That's not safe, by the way, that traditional approach. Because you know what, if punishments worked, you wouldn't need to keep doing them. So I sat with Devin with his exploration of fire for years. Today, my son is 17 and he's a blacksmith. He makes knives and swords, and he sells them on Etsy. He makes his own clothes. He's also a professional fire twirler and educates people in how to do it. It's actually become a really amazing experience. He has his friends over, and we have people contact us as a rite of passage, fire twirling, for children to try with their parents present and for the parent to hold the space of taking deep breaths while their child twirls fire right in front of them. Seeing how capable they are. I can't even imagine if I would have given into that fear. Not only the fear, but what other people said. It's hard when you first become a parent, especially for women, to go against what most people are telling you to do. I can remember my mother-in-law was like my idol. Like, she taught me how to clean a toilet. I remember she taught me everything. She was so earthy. I loved that because I was never like a crunchy, earthy person. I kind of am now a little bit, but I never was then. And I remember just everything she taught me blew my mind, and I wanted to please her. I wanted her to love me, you know, like I had a deeply held desire to be loved and accepted by her. But you guys know where that comes from, especially for women? From the time we were little girls, we were raised to please other people. And we were told that if we were pleasing to be around, that we were lovable, and then we accepted ourselves. So this conditioning went on that was very much for the convenience of the adults in our lives, for obedience, and they told us we were good little girls, and we felt so good about ourselves, and she's so pretty, and she's so sweet, she's such a good girl. And you know, we deeply, deeply, that's in our cells. When you have kids, it was hard for me to be faced with a decision to be loved or trust myself and trust my son. I remember the day, I remember sitting alone holding him the day he got home from the hospital. My mother-in-law told me, just make sure you don't hold him too much. Like when you need to go put him down in the cradle and let him be there and let him cry for a while, because if you hold him too much, he's going to expect it. You have to condition him not to manipulate or take advantage of you. And you know, I thought she was a pretty wise woman. I'm like, all right, that kind of makes sense, I guess. You know, I remember she left and I put him in the cradle and I sat on the couch and I was like looking at him through the bars. And he started crying, and like his little arms were like reaching. They weren't quite reaching for me, but at the time that's what I thought, because he was a newborn, they're just reaching. I'm just like, he wants me. And he started crying, and I'm like sitting there like, okay, this is so pointless. Why am I sitting here? And I went over and I picked him up. And that's when everything like crumbled. It was just amazing. Life went from black and white to color, and I said, I swear I will never, ever again not listen to you and my instinct. And something happened. I was born like a new person at that moment of just like finally honoring my instinct and being authentic in who I really was. And that happens to us as women when we walk this path, and for fathers, but in a different way. You become authentic. You finally discover who you are and who you are meant to be. And when you're allowed to parent in a way that meets your natural instinct, it brings up a lot from our past. It could be painful. There's so many memories that I hold that, and mind you, I'm not putting blame. I think that's important when you're walking this path. It's so tempting to blame our parents or blame the adults. They did what they knew how to do. I don't put blame, but I do honor that part of me that was abused, and we all were on some level. Emotionally from the authoritarian paradigm of the adults that were too inconvenient to focus on my needs. So this path is really healing, and it can be painful because it does trigger a lot of deeply held pain. But at the same time, when you heal and you grow walking this path, it's amazing how you grow into who you're meant to be as a person. I never thought I could stand in front of people and talk, ever. It was like my worst nightmare, and I put the two and two together that I must be awful at it and I'm awful in front of people, because everything I was forced to do that with was stuff I wasn't interested in. Oral reports in school, all these lame things. I had no voice. That meant nothing to me to talk about these things other people told me to talk about. But when you are a messenger of something that you have a lot of passion for, you can't not talk about it. It's just gonna come out. You might drive people crazy along the way a little bit. You gotta obey and respect, right? That forced learning idea. If people don't wanna hear what you have to say, man, they're gonna tune you right out. Nah, don't obey. Do what your heart tells you. How much time do we have? I'm a little, where we're so late. I'll just keep talking. You guys can just shut me down when you're done hearing me. So I think it's important to realize that this life, a lot happens, a lot's brought up. As you're walking this path with your kids of freedom and you decide to step into this space. Modern education focuses on a cookie cutter approach. I'm sure you guys got that right over the gist of the day, that's how it works, like a cookie cutter approach. And when you honor what your kids are really interested in and passionate about, and you help them become the people that they're meant to be by facilitating their passions, I'm not living this life to keep my kids in like this vacuum and this bubble, this protected little bubble, which is what a lot of people might think when you choose to homeschool. There are a lot of people that homeschool for that reason, to keep their kids in this safe place. They all have different intentions. we decided to live this life for many reasons, but one is because I wanted to give my kids as big of a world as possible to learn and grow from. I wanted to give them a huge world, not keep them in a brick building all day, every day for 12 years with kids their own age. Age segregation is really damaging. I don't know if you guys have ever heard that term before, but I encourage you again to look up John Taylor Gatto and read about his ideas on age segregation and see how damaging they are. An aspect of living this life that's really important is you don't want your kids to think that once they turn 18, they're done learning. How many of you thought that? Like when you graduated high school, you were like, oh, thank God, now I can just watch TV. You know, like you thought you were done. What you were done with was being forced to learn what you didn't want to learn. However, we tend to think that it's learning that we don't want to do. And we tend to fall into jobs working for somebody else, living these mundane lives like everybody else, chasing just that next paycheck to get through it. You guys can make money. Your kids can make money. You can make money in a life, making a difference in this world based on what you love to do. So I would really encourage you to understand that radical unschooling is not just a philosophy for your kids. This is a life philosophy. A side effect of living this will be healing. The other side effect is you to rediscover what you love. I want my kids to know that learning never ends. My kids always see me growing and pursuing crazy interests. You have to model for them that that's what learning is. You're always learning and growing and changing and evolving as people. We're meant to keep growing. If you're not evolving and you're not pursuing something, it hurts. You're depressed. We don't realize that how much effort it initially takes. You have to make an effort to just say to yourself, you know, lay in bed tonight and say, what have I always wanted to learn? It's pretty shocking that not many people have asked you guys that before, probably. What do you want to learn? Like, what do you love? And rediscover that. Sign up for a class. Do something online. Look up, YouTube has so many amazing videos on anything you want to learn about. That's how Devin learned to blacksmith. My son makes all his own clothes. He loves it. I hate sewing because I was forced to do it in school.
Something where he sells his fabric.
Oh, yeah, that's my son is just, I wish he could be here, because hearing it from him is pretty profound, but he was contacted by a producer for a movie that's doing a recreation of the Vikings movies. I mean, the Vikings, like, show. There's, like, a production. Have you ever heard of the Vikings show? There's a production, like, movies being put out, and they contacted him to make the fabric for the costuming, because they saw he's on a bunch of Viking groups, and he literally weaves his own. He made his own, what do they call those things? He'd be so embarrassed that I didn't know. Oh my goodness, like a weaver. What's something? A loom, yes. He's made tons of looms, and he makes his own fabric, and then he makes his own clothes, and he's really into a very specific kind of time in history, though. It's like the Norwegian, I'm not sure, it's the Norwegian Vikings specifically. He's very, very passionate about it. And he was contacted to, they said they will buy as much fabric as he could make for the next 2 years. And they pay $150 a yard. Because it's handmade, 100% wool. He literally, you know, when you get wool from sheep and you make it into yarn, that's what he does. Yeah. You know, I love, my kids' interests are really quirky, and my son Devin is really kind of primitive. Like, he's always been really into nature and totally primitive. And my daughter Tiffany is 14. She's very different. She loves modern pop culture. For the first time, she pursued a really important dream of hers this year, and she has walked a runway in New York City. She's a model. She loves beauty. She loves makeup. She loves fashion. So seeing me and hearing a story maybe just about Devin would kind of lead you to believe, wow, these kids are going to be really primitive and naturally minded, and no, they're going to be individuals. They're going to be who they're meant to be and have that nurtured. And that is something Tiffany loves to do. I'm so proud of her, and she's so happy, and it's crazy. And then my daughter Ivy, who was here, she's a totally different type of individual. She's more of a hardcore girl, I like to call her. She loves heavy metal. Her favorite band is Papa Roach, and we took her to see them with Five Finger Death Punch. She was the only kid, I think, in the whole audience. And man, they came out and she was bawling. And I swear Papa Roach, like they were, I swear the singer saw her and was like, what the heck is up with this kid? And she also loves The Walking Dead. anything bloody, anything horror. We brought her to meet Chandler Riggs, one of the main stars of The Walking Dead, and she was beside herself. We honor whatever our kids are interested in without judgment, with total love and support, so they can pursue and find and be facilitated in who they were meant to be. And I'm happy to say that my kids are happy, and they're making a living already, my two older kids, off what they absolutely love doing. So when somebody asks them, what do you want to be when you grow up, they have no concept at all of what somebody's asking them. I mean, they do now because we've talked about it, but they're like, I'm something now. I'm a blacksmith. I'm a model. I am something now. Our kids don't need to wait until they jump through the hoops that somebody else tells them to jump through to be something that's approved of in the list of respected professions. They might decide to go that route, but more than likely, they're going to blossom in who they're meant to be, and them living out loud and sharing who they are will help shift this world toward more peace and love. Because when you're living in a partnership-based paradigm and you're valuing what your kids' needs are, not just their behavior, you're valuing their needs as much as your own, and mind you, it's a lot of work to focus on how to meet everybody's needs in the family equally. You're modeling for your kids that everybody's needs matter in this world, and how much closer could we get to world peace than living that? So thank you.
Very nice. So we do have a few minutes. If you guys have questions, you heard some very exciting information.
Hi. Can you recommend a book or a website or just your own experience of how you can go about setting yourself up with the tools to defend your educational choices to your in-laws or your neighbors or, you know?
I honestly think the best way is community, is finding other people walking your path and asking them and just coming together and sharing. I know initially when I first started walking an alternative kind of path, I didn't know there was a name for what I was doing, and I found out that it was attachment parenting, which is a more naturally based kind of parenting. And I would send my mother-in-law articles all the time of like co-sleeping and extended breastfeeding and all these naturally minded things, and thinking that when she read them, she would like totally get it and then love me and accept me and tell me I was okay and I could then love myself and that whole mess. Well, instead she said that I was being a born again parent and totally rejected everything I was saying. Well, further down the path, years down the path of pain and agonizing and suffering and victimization in my head with her and I learned a new way of being. And that was like really creating my own reality and focusing on what we had in common instead of what our differences were. I wrote a Facebook update last week, I think it was, and it said, people will stop giving you their opinion when you stop looking for their approval. So stop looking for that and notice when you are, because when you are, and that's so natural too, but that's broken pieces within you and you need to find approval from your own conditioning to just be confident and parent, you know, proudly. But you do have to walk your own path and find what doesn't work. But so my tools would be to reach out to people online, whether it's a Facebook group or a community, maybe exchange numbers with other people living this life and just create your own community of support, and you won't feel the need to explain or defend.
Thank you. Another question for Dana? Probably one more after this, so if you have that, prepare yourself, please.
Did your children ever have the choice to go to school?
My kids always have the choice to go to school, yeah,
have
from the beginning.
Have they ever experienced going to school?
No. They've never decided to go. When we were on the show Wife Swap, they did go for 45 minutes to like this alternative school with just one teacher, but it wasn't really school. They just had them write their name or something. It was just kind of for the show, but no, they'd never been. They don't think they could ever really feel free. I mean, I've talked to my kids about it, and they said they have no desire to, that they wouldn't even know how to be with being so disrespected in an environment where they had to raise their hand to go to the bathroom or do what they're told in that way. Like, it would be hard for them, but they've always had the freedom, yes.
And one final question, Kathy.
As a mother trying something totally new, what are your fears?
My fears? Ooh, that's a good question. That's kind of like my inner work, my personal development journey is to let go of fears. I think you guys will notice that anytime you're afraid, you feel like controlling. So anytime you feel like controlling your kids or your partner or somebody else, it's because you're afraid. That's a pretty heavy question. The ocean, I don't like the ocean. No. As fears as far as my kids are concerned, I don't have any, like I really have 100% trust on this path. But I think I have just normal fears anybody would. My son goes down to visit his girlfriend in in Virginia, and she's unschooled too. And so he stays for like a month at a time down there, and she comes up here for just as long. When he's not with me and he's down there, sometimes I'm like, oh, I hope he's okay. Hope he's eating enough. Hope he's, you know, just the typical, probably what my husband and kids are thinking about me right now. Like, I hope mom's okay, but can you be more specific? Because I don't want to brush it off as, oh, I don't have any. Do you mean parenting or?
I totally understand that more than being an educational model, it's a parenting life model, which is above education. I get that. But it's, I mean, I would be very scared of doing something like you do, but I love it. So in terms of encouraging other people, other parents, what is it that you go through every day in terms of fears, which I have?
That's a great, yeah, I know what, more what you're asking now, awesome. There's a woman that you might find really helpful online. Her name is Byron Katie. She does something called The Work, and she really breaks down. So say that you're afraid of something, she would say, you know, why are you afraid of that? And is that fear true? Could that happen? And really, the inner work necessary to walk this path is vast. There's a lot. So really asking myself, why am I afraid of that? And working on that self-work. There's been times actually where I've told my kids, you know, I'm kind of nervous about that, you doing that right now. I know I trust you, it's just my stuff and I got to work through it a little bit before I'm comfortable. Can you guys just hold out for me? And they get it. Like, I'm not putting it on them like I don't trust them. But being honest and vulnerable with your kids is really important. And that's something, again, that we're so conditioned not to do, because we're told that if we show a weakness, they'll take advantage of you. You know, never show a weakness when it comes to authority. So it's really hard for parents sometimes, and I'm surprised, but it is. Understandably so, when you say, just be real with them. I tell my kids, you know, Ivy, you going down in the mosh pit at this concert, like, I know you want to and I trust you, but I just need to work through a little few fears with it and talk to you about it. So we'll talk about it. Sometimes the fears are really valid, but we'll discuss them, and it's never forced. It'll be like, I'll exchange information. And because we don't live in a controlling dynamic and we don't live in that authoritarian paradigm, when I give them information, they believe me. There's a big difference. Because when you're controlling and there's fear of punishment, they believe, when you say something, they think you're trying to control them, and there's really this huge distrust and disconnect. So the connection necessary to live this path, people say, well, what do? Well, I tell my kids what I know, and I give them resources to learn more. So if I am afraid of something, we talk about it. Maybe my fear is valid, maybe it's not. But I value their opinion.
Awesome. Dana Martin, ladies and gentlemen, can say thank you.